Good evening, doctors. Welcome again. Today we are going to discuss about endocrinology MCQs. Let's start. A 28-year-old woman comes to the clinic complaining of slow enlarging hard mass on the right hand side of neck. There are no other associated symptoms and she is otherwise well. The only medication of note is oral contraceptive pills. On examination, she has 3-4 cm mass on the right hand side of her neck. Thyroid function test reveals TSS 3.4. Her calcium is 2.4. Which of the following is the most likely underlying cause here? This is a case of papillary carcinoma. Okay. 78-year-old woman presents to the clinic for review after a second coulis fracture. On further questioning, she admits to being very poorly compliant with her biphosphonates because of severe indigestion. Other past medical history of note includes a pulmonary embolus for which she was treated with warfarin for a period of 6 months. T-score is measured 4.5. Which of the following is an appropriate treatment here? Treatment by denosumab. Okay. 32-year-old man who has a type 1 diabetes for 20 years comes to the clinic for review. His HbA1c has drifted higher over the past few months and has now reached 8.3%. He has tried increases basal insulin but is suffering from increased nocturnal hypoglycemia. According to NICE guidelines, which is the most appropriate basal insulin for him? That is insulin glargine. Okay. These are the explanation. You can pause this video and read. Okay. A 79-year-old man is brought to the emergency department by ambulance from his nursing home. He is known to take a number of medication for a type 2 diabetes and the staff were unable to wake him from sleep in the morning. He has recently been investigated for chronic renal impairment and he has been ill with diarrhea and vomiting. On admission, the department, his finger prick blood glucose is measured 1.9 millimoles per liter. Which of the following medication is most likely to have been responsible for this? That is glibenclamide. Okay. 30-year-old woman is seen for the fourth time in 2 years in accident and emergency with abdominal pain and vomiting. Clinical examination reveals a thin young woman with widespread skin pigmentation. Blood test demonstrate hyponatremia. Pregnancy test is negative. Abdominal x-ray is unremarkable due to persistent on-call who considered a diagnosis of Addison disease. A random cortisol level is sent and the laboratory Addison disease random through to inform. Cortisol level is sent to laboratory, subsequently phones through to inform you that undetectable. Which of the following is the most in keeping with diagnosis of primary autoimmune adrenal insufficiency? That is eosinophilia. Okay. Now, 32-year-old man, liar, presents with weight loss and agitation and diarrhea. On examination, he is noted to have warm skin and sinus tachycardia. Blood test confirmed thyrotoxicosis, strongly positive TSH receptor antibody, and he is treated accordingly. Several months later, he presents with dry, gritty eyes, having done some research on the internet. He is very concerned and would like to ask you some question about Graves' ophthalmopathy. Which of the following statement he presents to you is correct? This is more common in women. Okay. 78-year-old female presents to her GP with general malaise, confusion, abdominal pain. Her past medical history consists of hypertension, for which she treated with AC inhibitor. She gave up smoking 2 years ago, having previously smoked 20 cigarettes a day for 30 years. Investigation showed normal full blood count, thyroid and renal function, calcium 2.89 higher side, PTH 7, ACE is 88, 24-hour urinary calcium excretion elevated. What is most likely diagnosis? This is a case of primary hyperparathyroidism. Okay. 23-year-old woman is brought into A&E, drowsy and confused. She is unable to give a history of GCS. Is 9 and there is some vomit around the mouth. Examination pulse 102, BP 78/35, saturation 98%. On air temperature 37.5, on auscultation of her chest, a few crackles at the right base. Her BM is 3.2 millimoles. Blood test reveals sodium 123, potassium 5.9, urea 7.9, creatinine 118. Which of the following treatment is most urgent? Intravenous hydrocortisone or hypertonic saline. Let's see. Intravenous hydrocortisone, because this is an Addison crisis. So, hope now it's clear. Sorry, guys. So, here the answer is intravenous hydrocortisone. This one, hydrocortisone. Okay. Now, ...38-year-old woman with 30-year history of type 1 diabetes attends the clinic for review. She is currently managed with a basal bolus insulin regimen, glargine, and atropine regimen. Her blood pressure is 112/72. She has microalbuminuria and recent creatinine is 95. HbA1c is 7.1. Which of the following appropriate course of action? Add enalapril. Treated to maximum tolerated dose. Okay. 30-year-old woman complains of being thirsty more than usual and notes that she has been visiting the toilet more frequently to pass urine. No complaints about dysuria or foul smelling urine. Her urea and electrolytes are as follows: sodium 125, potassium 4.5, urea 7, creatinine 120, corrected calcium 2.4. Which would be the next appropriate investigation? Do serum glucose. Firstly, rule out diabetes in this case. Okay. 71-year-old man fell off a ladder and was knocked out. He had a CT head scan, which reveals a 1.3 centimeter macroadenoma, not encroaching the optic chiasm. He recovered well from the fall, and examination including visual fields was entirely normal. His thyroid function test, sensing test, and testosterone levels are normal. Prolactin is 550. Which of the following is the most appropriate treatment? No further monitor with serial imaging. Okay. An 80-year-old woman comes to hospital with confusion and unable to give a full history. On examination, she is underweight with a fine tremor of the fingers. She has lid lag and pre-tibial mesenchyma. Her blood test follows. TSH 0.001, T4 250, total T3 3.5. What is the cause? Cause here is Graves' disease. Okay. 25-year-old woman with a history of Addison disease comes to the clinic for review. She is currently taking 20 mg of hydrocortisone in the morning, 10 mg in the evening, happily. She is 8 weeks pregnant with her first child. Which of the following is the correct advice with respect to her corticosteroids? Increase dose by 10 mg per day in third trimester. Okay. With regard to multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1, which is the most appropriate answer? Measurement of serum calcium is useful in screening test of for suspected cases. Pancreatic parathyroid and thyroid not. Yeah, this is the right answer. Measurement of serum calcium is useful in screening test for suspected cases. Okay. 63-year-old man, weighing 75 kg, presented in the A&E department after a car accident in which he pulled out into a main road and was hit by a passing car. He was not on any drugs. He complains of numbness in his fingers and blames the accident on this. He is found to be hypertensive. Pulse 84. Routine blood test reveals 5.8. Serum creatinine 100. Serum potassium 4.5. Random glucose is 10.8. TSS less than 0.05. What is the cause of hypertension here? This is a case of Cushing disease. Okay. This is a case of acromegaly. Sorry guys, not Cushing disease. Let's discuss this question again. 63, weight to 75, with car accident, pulled into the main road, hit by a car, not on any drug, complaints of numbness fingers, found hypertensive 90/110, sinus rhythm, heart rate is, pulse is 84, urea normal, creatinine normal, potassium normal, sugar higher side, and TSH less than 0.05, that is by acromegaly. Okay. This we discuss. The combination of secondary diabetes and hypertension is seen in Cushing syndrome and acromegaly. In the former, one might have exposed serum potassium to be low and obesity. Numbness in patient fingers, secondary carpal tunnel syndrome, is not uncommon complication of acromegaly. Caused by accident was due to failure to see the car as a result of bitemporal hemianopia, secondary to pituitary tube. Okay. Now, sorry. 75-year-old woman referred to the endocrine clinic with a rapidly enlarging hard neck mass. She also has a worsening cough pain around her neck and shortness of breath, particularly when she lies flat. Sorry. On examination, there is a hard neck mass extending out of the left side of the neck. The evidence of local lymph node enlarged. Investigation TSH 1.3, calcium 2.4, ESR 85. Fine needle aspiration biopsy. Multiple spindle cells. The diagnosis here is anaplastic thyroid carcinoma. Okay. 40-year-old woman presents with lethargy and tiredness 6 months after delivery of fifth child. Her symptoms have been blamed on her busy family commitments, and her urea, electrolytes, liver function test normal. Hemoglobin 11.7, free T4, 6, TSH is less than 0.01. What is the likely cause of her symptoms? So, this is a case of Graves' disease. 6 months after delivery for fifth child, not Graves. Yeah. What is Sheehan syndrome? This is a case of Sheehan syndrome, not a Graves. Postpartum pituitary hemorrhage. Yeah. Okay. Now, 76-year-old woman admitted to the hospital with respiratory tract infection. She has had a cough for the past few days and was found to her daughter confused and rambling, sitting in her lounge. There is a past history of myocardial infarction, diet control, diabetes mellitus. On examination, pyrexial 38.2. Signs of right lower lobe pneumonia. Hemoglobin 11, WCC 13, platelet 214, sodium 116, potassium 4.1, creatinine 100, albumin 38. ALT 54, how would you manage the hyponatremia? By 3% saline infusion, by fluid resuscitation. Why? Because we are not going to rapidly correct sodium. If we rapidly correct, it damages the brain. Okay. 50-year-old woman with episodic chronic diarrhea and generalized abdominal pain was noted to have an enlarged thyroid gland. Blood pressure 187/110. Ultrasound study, thyroid gland shows enlarged both lobes of thyroid. Multiple lymph node glands, enlargement in the neck. Bowel studies were normal. What is the likely diagnosis here? This is a case of multiple endocrine neoplasia. Okay. Case of multiple endocrine neoplasia. You were referred a 23-year-old woman of low intelligence from whom little history was obtainable. She has been found to have a serum calcium corrected 1.6, serum phosphate 2.2, normal renal function, and there have been no previous hospital admission. Her brother died of asthma. What is the cause of her low serum calcium? Pseudo hypoparathyroidism. It is mainly due to pseudo hypoparathyroidism. Pseudo hypoparathyroidism. Okay. You can pause this video, read the explanation. Here also you can pause and read the explanation. Okay. 65-year-old woman who is under the urologist for intervention of renal stones. Present with polydipsia, polyuria, increasing fatigue. Blood test reveals albumin 48, calcium 3.3, phosphate 0.49, urea 16, creatinine 168, parathyroid hormone is 167. Most likely diagnosis is, this is a case of primary hyperparathyroidism. Which of the following is a true for Kohn syndrome? Successfully treated by spironolactone. It has, okay, now, a 53-year-old woman comes to the clinic for review a few weeks after the birth of her first baby by cesarean section. She suffered a postpartum hemorrhage, required 3-unit blood transfusion. She is feeling tired, is gaining weight and increasingly nauseous. On examination, her BP is 132/82. Investigation, hemoglobin 11, WCC is 8, platelets 183, sodium 128, potassium 4.9, creatinine 112. What is most likely diagnosis? Sorry. So this is a case of pituitary failure. Okay. Patient is found to have a pheochromocytoma. She reports that her mother had the same thing. Which of these conditions not typically associated with familial pheochromocytoma? That is familial adenomatous polyposis, not associated. 53-year-old woman was initially referred because of marked weakness and hypokalemia. She reported a history of hypertension. Further investigation shows significantly high plasma aldosterone levels. What is the next test did you consider? So next test here is plasma aldosterone and plasma renin level. Okay. 61-year-old man with a history of type 2 diabetes comes to the clinic complaining of hypoglycemia in the late afternoon. His HbA1c 8.4%. Takes BD mixed insulin 30/70, 22 units in morning, 18 units in evening. His blood pressure 152/72. Has microalbuminuria. Which of the following is the correct course of action respect to the insulin regimen? Transfer him to muscle bolus insulin. Okay. Now, a 17-year-old boy comes to the clinic for review with his parents. He started insulin therapy for a new onset type 1 diabetes some 2 weeks earlier. They have read about residual insulin production being associated with better potential outcomes and want to know about the best way to preserve their son beta cell function. His C-peptide by mixed meal test was being measured at 1.4. Which of the following represents the most appropriate intervention with respect to preserving beta cell function? That is, intensive glycemic control. Okay. 62-year-old woman with a long history of type 2 diabetes, now managed with. Worsening night mixed insulin comes to the clinic with worsening nighttime pain and paresthesia related to peripheral neuropathy. Other medications include ramipril, atorvastatin, indapamide, aspirin. She has tried rubbing excessive cream into her legs, but it seems to be give her little benefit. Investigation: hemoglobin 10.8. WCC 7.3, platelets 194, sodium 137, potassium 4.4, creatinine 138, HbA1c 7.4. Which of the following is the most appropriate treatment? Duloxetine for peripheral neuropathies. Okay. 23-year-old man with 19-year history of type 1 diabetes comes to the clinic for review. He takes a bolus insulin regimen, and after many years poor blood glucose control, it has improved after the past 2 years. HbA1c is 7.3, BP is 110/72. He has background diabetic retinopathy. Which of the following management steps likely to have biggest impact on his retinopathy progression? Start enalapril. Okay. Old man brought into the hospital by ambulance, having been found passers by collapsed outside a shopping center. examination is unremarkable and there are no signs of trauma. During resuscitation, a colleague notes that the patient is wearing a metal bracelet with the words of type 1 diabetes engraved on it. Further tests are conducted. A capillary blood glucose reading is high and arterial blood gas demonstrates significantly metabolic acidosis. Further results available. Management continues. Sodium 129, potassium 4, urea 10, creatinine 120, chloride 90, HCLO is 18, glucose 32. Which of the following corresponds with the patient anion gap? That is 13. Yeah. Normal anion gap is 6 to 16. Okay. ...64-year-old woman, admitted from home. Having been found barely conscious on the floor by her home help, it looks like she has had fall. She has a history of type 2 diabetes, for which she takes metformin. On examination, she is pyrexial. BP 105/70, pulse 100. She has signs of her right-sided pneumonia and appears not to be moved her left leg side. Investigation: hemoglobin 11.6, white cell 12.1, platelets 192, serum sodium 151, serum potassium 4.1, creatinine 172, glucose 38.9. Which of the following represents an average recommended IV fluid replacement during his first 4 hours, that is 3 liters? You are reviewing a 51-year-old man with a history of type 2 diabetes who has failed to tolerate metformin monotherapy due to diarrhea, so has been started on sulfonylurea. The reduction in HbA1c seen has been extremely impressive at 1.2% over the past 4 months. Which of the following is a gene thought to be involved in a response of sulfonylurea? That is KCNJ11. Okay. 36-year-old woman has been undergoing treatment for primary infertility and presents unwell with tachycardia. Blood pressure 88/50 and abdominal swelling. Blood test shows urea 15.6. Serum creatinine 165 and serum albumin 20. Pregnancy test negative. What is the cause of her abdominal swelling? Ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. Okay. 56-year-old man with type 2 diabetes comes to the clinic for review. He is currently taking metformin monotherapy 1 gram BD. He has recently been admitted with anterior myocardial infarct, received an LAD stent, but has degree of cardiac failure since. Other medication now includes ramipril, furosemide, atorvastatin, aspirin and clopidogrel. Examination: BP is 125/72, pulse 82. There are bivessel crackles on auscultation of the chest. His BMI 33, HbA1c 8.3, creatinine 122. Which of the following is the most appropriate additional medication to improve his blood glucose control? That is liraglutide. Yeah. ...45-year-old man with long-standing type 1 diabetes comes to the clinic for review, complaint of worsening of blood glucose control. Reports painful induration and urticarial rash appearing the site of his long-acting insulin injection. Examination: you confirm multiple areas of urticaria induration. HbA1c risen 7.4 to 9% over the last 6 months. Which of the following is most likely diagnosis? Lipohypertrophy. Okay. No, this is not lipohypertrophy. This is an insulin allergy. That's why the rashes occurs. Okay. A 19-year-old anorexic woman, consent to admission for parenteral nutrition. Her BMI has fallen to 16.3 and she is dangerously ill. She begins parenteral nutrition prepared by the on-call dietitian over the weekend. Unfortunately, a few hours later, she became severely unwell with muscle weakness, hypotension 95/60, pulse 95, bilateral crackles, on auscultation of her chest. Electrolyte has not been adequately replaced in her nutritional program, that is phosphate. Okay. 24-year-old man with 47XXY chromosome. Abnormality attends infertility clinic. Which of the following would be the most likely finding of clinical examination? That is tall stature. This is a case of Klinefelter syndrome. Okay. 50-year-old diabetic man admitted with confusion and a blood glucose is 2.5. Which of these medication does not usually cause hypoglycemia when used in monotherapy? Metformin. Okay. Okay. Now, 25-year-old man admitted to A&E. Confusion and breathlessness. According to his housemates, he has been increasingly thirsty over few days and waking up to pass urine many times a night. His atrial blood gas is follows: PS 7.2, PO2 is 14.8, PaCO2 2.8, SCO 3.7. What is the investigation likely to be most useful confirming the diagnosis? Do blood glucose first. 72-year-old man with a history of chronic renal failure comes to the clinic for review. He also has type 2 diabetes despite diet and exercise measures falling adequately to control his glucose. On examination, BP 155/80, pulse 80, regular, BMI 31, investigation hemoglobin 11, WCC 7.7, platelet 192, sodium 138, potassium 5, creatinine 162, estimated GFR 42, HbA1c 7.9. Which of the following is the most appropriate treatment for controlling his blood glucose? That is linagliptin or metformin. Yeah, linagliptin. When GFR is less than 60, go for linagliptin. Okay. An 18-year-old woman with a history of anorexia nervosa is commenced on nasogastric feeding after admission on Saturday morning via psychiatry teams. You are fast blab to see her. Some 3 days later, after she collapses and is witnessed by the nurses to suffer a tonic-clonic seizure. Her BP 105/78, pulse is 85 and regular. You note her BMI admission is 16.5. Which of the following is the most likely the cause of her collapse? That is hypophosphatemia. A 29-year-old man comes to the endocrine clinic for review having suffered a road traffic accident in which sustained a head injury some 6 weeks earlier. Since then, he tells you she has been passing large volumes of urine, had difficulty keeping up as fluid intake. Examination: BP 120/60, pulse 80, postural drop 15 mmHg on standing, mild hypernatremia. Urine examination routine: urine osmolarity reaches 290, fluid deprivation but does not rise to more than 800 after desmopressin. Which of the following is the most appropriate treatment here? That is desmopressin treatment here by desmopressin. Okay. 19-year-old woman with an eating disorder admitted to medical ward for refeeding under the Mental Act. Her BP 100/60, pulse 75 regular. Her BMI is 16.5. Which of the following is most likely to be seen on investigation? That is elevated cortisol level. Okay. You review a 53-year-old man with type 2 diabetes who is unable to gain glycemic control on metformin monotherapy alone. HbA1c 8.4, BP 155/85, pulse 85, BMI 35. You elect to begin dapagliflozin. Which of the following correctly reflects the mode of action? Blocks renal tubular glucose reabsorption. Okay. 12-year-old boy presents to the clinic with a new diagnosis of type 1 diabetes. His 4-year-old brother and mother also have type 1 diabetes. Which of the following HLA is most likely to have is DR3, HLA DR3. Okay. Now, a 59-year-old woman presents to the clinic for review of her type 2 diabetes. She is currently taking 1 gram BD metformin, but HbA1c has steadily risen 8.2% over the past few months. You elect to begin dapagliflozin. Which of the following is true regarding dapagliflozin? Leads to excretion of approximately 70 gram glucose per day in a patient with type 2 diabetes. Okay. An 88-year-old woman presents to the emergency department with gradually worsening stridor over a period of months. On clinical examination, she has a normal respiratory rate and oxygen saturation, hemodynamically stable, but you note a large goiter. A CT scan is performed which confirms external compression of the trachea by extrathoracic goiter. Lung function tests are performed prior to bronchoscopic stenting to the trachea. What pattern would you expect to find on lung function result? Normal expiratory flow volume loop with flattening of inspiratory flow. Okay. Yes. Now, 31-year-old woman recently diagnosed Graves' disease comes to the emergency department complaining of diplopia. On examination, there is obvious exophthalmos with conjunctival edema. On testing, there is some lack of color vision and limited upward gaze. Which of the following is the appropriate intervention? So the most appropriate intervention here is start high dose IV methylprednisolone. Okay. We already discussed these questions. Yeah, already discussed. Now, 28-year-old man who complains of polyuria polydipsia comes to endocrinology clinic, complains of some 6 weeks after a motorcycle accident, knocked unconscious. He tells you he is thirsty all the time and drinking 8 liters of ice cold water and other drinks each day. Calcium and glucose levels normal. Arrange him to admit water deprivation test. Osmolality 280. Rise to 850 milliosmol per kg after DDAPV administration. Which of the following is most likely diagnosis? This is a case of psychogenic polydipsia. Okay. 34-year-old woman comes to the clinic for review. She has recently been diagnosed with diabetes insipidus after presenting to the clinic with polyuria, polydipsia, whilst on lithium therapy. Her medication with bipolar disorder has been changed to sodium valproate. She is still having drinking up to 7 liters per day. Keep with her fluid requirements. Which of the following is the optimal way to manage her? This is nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, lithium induced. So give her bendroflumethiazide. Okay. Sorry guys, this is not psychogenic, this is a cranial diabetes insipidus. Why? Because here after desmopressin administration in rise in osmolality, that's why. Okay, now 22-year-old woman comes to the clinic because she has had menstrual periods for the past 5 months. On further questioning, she confirmed that she has no sex drive, had no menstrual periods, experienced milk leakage from breast. You perform a set of investigation. These includes multiple negative pregnancy tests. Her prolactin is measured 5120. MRI scan reveals pituitary macroadenoma extend into cavernous sinus. Which is the most appropriate initial therapy for her? Cabergoline. Okay. Yeah. 28-year-old woman presents to the emergency department to the third time over the past 9 months with abdominal pain and distress. She has recently begun visiting her GP because of symptoms of anxiety and a sign of work and long-term sick leave. Examination BP is 167 by 100 and 100 regular pulse. She has abdominal pain on palpation. Although the abdomen is soft and she vomits during the examination of note. In her investigation are low sodium 130 and normal plain abdominal film. On reviewing her past notes, you note a low sodium to previous admission. Which of the following is most likely to yield the diagnosis? Urinary porphyrins. This is an acute intermittent porphyria. Yeah. A 60-year-old taxi driver comes to the diabetes clinic for review. He has a type 2 diabetes for the past 6 years and maintained on metformin 1 gram BD. Other past history noted transitional cell carcinoma of bladder, which he under regular surveillance. His hemoglobin HbA1c is recorded 62. His creatinine 125. BMI is 35. BP 155 by 90. Which of the following is the next appropriate management? So add here sitagliptin. Okay. 33-year-old woman referred to a infertility clinic by GP. She gained 2 stone weight over past 9 months and has had no periods for 6 months. Monitor borderline hypertension. She takes no regular medication. BP 159 by 90, pulse 70. BMI 32, hemoglobin 12.8, WCC 8.3, platelet 190, sodium 137, potassium 4, creatinine 108, TSH 0.7, prolactin 930, cortisol 940, fasting glucose 6.2, FSH LHS suppressed. Which of the following is a diagnosis? So this is a case of Cushing syndrome. This is a case of Cushing syndrome. Okay. Yeah. ...22-year-old charity worker comes to emergency department for review. Complaints of polyuria, polydipsia and tells you that she needs to drink up 12 liters of water per day, remain hydrated. Past medical history notes include depression and anxiety, which has treated with citalopram, although she no longer takes any medication. examination BP 122 by 72, pulse 72. There are no abnormal findings. Urine and plasma osmolarity both low. Urine examination are in normal range. Corrected calcium 2.35. Fasting glucose 5.8. Which of the following is the correct course of action? Referral to cognitive therapy. This is a case of psychogenic polydipsia. Okay. A 28-year-old woman, old man, with a history of congenital nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, comes to the genetic clinic, and he new partner, he aware of the condition caused by mutation AVPR2 gene. The partner is 24-week pregnant and male child. They want to know the chance of child inheriting the condition. The partner family are not affected by the condition. What is the chance of the child having nephrogenic diabetes insipidus? Is 0%. Okay. 17-year-old man who has a history of diabetes mellitus is partially sighted, present to the clinic for review. Despite insulin therapy and tight control of his glucose, he is suffering from polyuria polydipsia. He also wears bilateral hearing aids because of sensorineural deafness. What pattern of inheritance fits best in this condition? So, this is an autosomal recessive pattern. Okay. Wolfram syndrome. Okay. 26-year-old man who has diagnosed acute intermittent porphyria comes to the clinic with her partner, discuss the wanting start family, ask about the possibility of their child inheriting disorder, that is autosomal dominant. Okay. Now, 19-year-old woman presents to emergency department with episode of anxiety, hypertension and hyponatremia. This is the third such episode in the past year, and all investigations so far have proved negative with respect to determining the underlying cause. Arranges a porphyria screen which suggests acute intermittent porphyria. Which of the following is the enzyme defect which underlines acute intermittent porphyria? That is porphyrobilinogen decarboxylase. So guys, I hope till here it's very much clear for you. If you have any queries, any question, you can ask me. And if you're new on my channel, please subscribe it. And if you like this video, put like on it. Thank you. Good day. Goodbye. That's all for today.